Secondo le stime,
according to the estimates of FAO, the world population will be above 9 billion people in the year 2050, an increase of roughly one-third compared to the 7 billion currently inhabiting our planet. Numbers which are no surprise to us, especially if we look at the demographic evolution of the last 100 years. Population increases foreseen for the next decades will be inferior to those of the past. And above all, an increase of the population of above 30% foreseen by FAO for the next 40 years will be slightly below the relative growth which has marked the last 40 years, in which population has nearly doubled. In any case, the planet will be inhabited by roughly 2.5 billion inhabitants more, and this in just a few decades. That is, in less than 20 years, the world will have 1 billion extra inhabitants, 1 billion mouths to feed. The greatest increases will take place in developing countries, while demographics in high-income countries will remain stable. And in some areas, especially in some regions of Europe, we might also have a drop in the number of inhabitants. Today, the world population is distributed in the following way: 50% in urban areas and the remaining 50% in rural areas. In 1950, only 28% of people actually lived in large urban areas. In the year 2050, this percentage will reach 70%. 19 extra cities compared to the number we have today will have more than 10 million inhabitants, and 5 of these will belong to the Asian area, where there's a tendency towards metropolitan concentration, and this will become all the more marked. And this trend will impact the presence of human beings in the countryside. FAO estimates that the active population working in agriculture will drop by 30% in the next 40 years. This will also orient consumption choices by great numbers of the world's population towards products with a higher service content and highly processed goods, changing the eating habits of the areas which are richest in the planet. The important contribution for the alignment of diets will be given by the growth of the middle class of emerging countries. There will be an increase in per capita income in future years in these group of people. The individual income of countries like India, Brazil, and China has grown at a sustained pace in recent years, and then slowed down, although didn't stop altogether, only during this long period of world economic crisis. The most astounding examples are those of China and India. There have been annual growth rates which are nearly double digit in the years just before the economic recession. And according to the International Monetary Fund, these should continue in their trend at least for the next 20 years. Well, dear friends, how does all this influence the relationship between the demand and supply of agricultural products? FAO, for some time, has been stating that to satisfy the food needs of a growing population, which will be richer and more urbanized, agricultural production destined to food uses will have to increase by 70% from now to the year 2050. To satisfy the world food production need, our production will be around 3 billion tons, that is one-third more compared to what we have today. That threshold will have to increase by 140%, and the meat production will have to reach 470 million tons, that is 200 more than the ones we have today. This, although the role of the world has become strategic, we see that there is a trend which we all know as land grabbing, which creates indeed a lot of concern. We don't have precise data, we have various figures, but we're certainly speaking of tens of millions of arable land, especially in the African continent, which have been the subject of transactions, the object of transactions transactions in recent years. The alarm as to the effect of these changes was triggered with the increase in agricultural commodity prices in 2007-2008, and then became a priority in the international political agenda, with a new peak of quotations between the end of 2010 and beginning of 2011. And so there has been a greater awareness that the balance of agricultural markets runs the risk of becoming increasingly precarious because of structural changes which go hand in hand with the evolution of world food demand. And from this threat, we have a debate on food scarcity, on how to feed the world in the year 2050, as the title of a recent report says. And the conclusions are similar to those contained in other very clear and eloquent studies. To win the challenge of food safety requires urgent actions, which must be carried out at an international level. If agricultural production will continue to grow at the same pace we've had in recent years, the gap between demand and supply will widen as early as in the near future, leading to an inevitable extension of the area of food unsafety, which is around 1.2 billion people in the world today. And so, also for our advanced economies and even for the rich countries of the world, there'll be an issue in terms of food supply security, a problem which appeared to have come to an end with the end of the Second World War. According to many analysts, these figures show that the Green Revolution is now over. We have reached a level of efficiency which will be difficult to go beyond in the short term, but there's a very heated and articulated debate on this topic, and all agree on one point, that is, that technological process, progress and its transfer continues to be the way for tackling the challenge of food safety and security. I believe that we must do something in the short term, and it's very important because the transfer of innovation can represent, not just in the world, but all over, decisive factors in order to improve our production of food products without indeed putting at stake our environment to produce more, polluting less. This is one of the goals. We always try to be optimistic, so we support a second point of view, that is, the possibility of giving an answer to this challenge. First of all, because we believe that the Green Revolution is not behind us. Some data recently published by a study commissioned by the British government entitled The Future of Food and Farming, Challenges and Choice for Global Sustainability, highlight clearly how there are still major spaces for a maneuver, and that we can exploit the benefits of the technical progress achieved so far. It's obvious that the possibility of transferring the technical benefits achieved in certain contexts compared to areas which are not that attractive will give rise to changes. For example, we have to change investments and help the development of poorer countries, and we must overcome the situation of political instability and conflict in certain areas of the planet. A view which is suggested by certain studies, and this can indeed lead to an increase in productivity and help, therefore, in our struggle against our hunger. But there's an alarming piece of data, because public expenditure devoted to research and development in the agricultural field constantly drops at a global level. It remains in a very unchanged situation in developing countries, and compared to the past, no one is investing more money. In some emerging countries, Brazil, China and India, investments in research and development for agriculture, although they grow but less strongly than in the past, remain still important, so they are an exception. The Brazilian agency, Lembrada, for Research in Agriculture is the largest in the world, with a budget which is above $1 billion. China, in the last 10 years, has increased its expenditure devoted to research in agriculture by 10% per year. If we go closer to the figure of $4 billion in the year 2008, that is how much they spent. trend. For the year 2007-2012, New Delhi has allotted a lot of money, and Chinese investments together with the Indian investments represent 70% of the total expenditure devoted to agriculture of the entire Asian continent. The reasons which have discouraged public research in recent years are due to the instability of markets, which we have just left behind us. The slow but constant decline of prices of foodstuffs, which had marked a period of overproduction, which lasted for roughly 50 years, and encouraged policies to support the sector in developed countries, has highlighted and cancelled out, indeed, the investments of richer countries for their food security. The increase of demand, accompanied with other factors, the increase of climate risks, the appreciation of certain currencies, has given rise to price volatility, and the fact that the market has very limited sizes in certain countries, both in terms of volumes and the number of exporters, makes this just worse. For example, foodstuffs destined to exports give us an idea of the figure. 12% of maize and 13% of wheat were destined to international markets. The rest remains within producing countries, and this means that the quantities exchanged are very limited. So even in the event of small shocks, price repercussions can be highly significant, and a return to balance can require a very long period of time. With such low volumes concentrated in the hands of few exporters, markets become very precarious, and small variations in the quantities exported or imported can increase or decrease prices significantly. The lack of coordination at an international level has done the rest, very often triggering off speculative activities which increase price volatility greatly. The reaction of governments when faced with peaked prices have been aimed at adopting protective measures, for example, the introduction to stop exports or incentives towards imports in order to alleviate the impact of price increases on citizens. But these initiatives, unfortunately, have only had the result of exporting instability and bringing instability from the inside to the outside, making price fluctuations even greater at an international level. In other words, a vicious circle which makes markets even more precarious. From 2007-2008, many cereal exporting countries have prohibited or limited their exports. The Ukraine, for example, has imposed maximum quotas, which then have become a total prohibition to exports. In Argentina, you cannot tax exports, and this is the same thing as saying that they cannot export. For example, Indonesia, Vietnam, for rice exports, have put on the red light. These actions, just like the announcements which preceded this, have played an important role in favoring uncertainty and panic amongst governments. And this has therefore prompted triggering off of panic on markets. But the experience of these 2 years hasn't taught us anything. In 2010, we have witnessed a whole series of measures which were totally uncoordinated at an international level. During the summer of last year, wildfires have destroyed harvests. Russia has prohibited the exports of wheat, and this has increased prices. This example was followed by the Ukraine too, and a lot of governments started adding subsidies to imports or reducing exports. The announcement was enough to get a lot of importers to start negotiating higher volumes compared to the past, and this because they feared price increases. According to FAO estimates, the prices of wheat have increased between 60% and 80% between July and September 2010 because of the prohibition to export wheat decided by Moscow. As an exception to this, these trends are becoming practice. And a lot of people who used to trade raw materials for a few months at a time are now intervening massively on markets for a longer period of time, such as Saudi Arabia. Their stocks have tripled for the same time period. We must rethink our trade rules. The challenge today is to rethink rules and the role of international policy. We must be aware that we're not dealing with something which is transitory. It is something structural which introduces us into a historic stage in which we will have to grapple with higher prices and more volatile markets. A recently published document coming from the G10 can be seen as a step forward in setting up an international safety for international food security. But let me remind you that to date, there is no change in the international institutional framework, which allows us to say that a future price crisis can be managed today in a different way compared to the past. In the short term, we can expect an agreement for a new enforcement of restrictions and rules for food acquired within the World Food Programme. Yes, you've understood. Also, humanitarian aid have been and are subject to the trade restrictions of exporting countries during periods of crisis. We must act urgently. We've got to start from the reorganization of our trade policies. We've got to start from a necessary reform of the rules of international trade with reference to practices which are limited to exports. We must redesign the framework within we must contain these measures, associating these only to exceptional cases and as a whole alternative to other instruments, other tools in order to keep down inflation or to control prices of foodstuffs. And we'll certainly go back to this point later during the debate. And we must also check the influence of restrictive measures. It's important to have an emergency governance system. The the WTO must be totally rethought, just like we must rethink all the tools we have in agricultural policy, just like the common agricultural policy of the European Union, which is being reformed. And this in unison with other international agricultural policies, the American Farm Bill, for example, involving different countries. We can no longer act in an uncoordinated way. We need more transparency, more information on the market to reduce speculation. And above all, we must increase research and innovation. We certainly cannot use most of the territory, as happens in the United States and in Europe too, to shift agricultural production towards the production of energy. The topic of biofuels must be tackled once and for all. Thank you very much.